لقد كان لكم في رسول الله أسوة حسنة لمن كان يرجو الله واليوم الآخر وذكر الله كثيرا.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. الحمد لله رب العالمين، الرحمن الرحيم، مالك يوم الدين، القدوس السلام ورزاق الكريم. أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله، صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. الله سبحانه وتعالى the Most High, He has created mankind, and He has made the nature of mankind, or the natural disposition of mankind, that He likes and He inclines to that which benefits Him, and He dislikes and He shuns away from that which harms Him or decreases the good that He has been given. And this is how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created all of mankind, that they strive and seek that which benefits them, as far as what they perceive as good. And all of mankind strives after what they perceive benefits them, and they flee from that which they perceive is harmful to them, or that which jeopardizes the good that they are in. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He explains this, as He says in His book, إِنَّ الْإِنسَانَ خُلِقَ هَلُوعًا, where mankind has been created impatient. إِذَا مَسَّهُ الشَّرُّ جَزُوعًا, if evil touches him, he's irritable. وَإِذَا مَسَّهُ الْخَيْرُ مَنُوعًا, and if good reaches him, then he's stingy. This is the nature of mankind, that he likes the good. And if evil comes to him, he's irritable and he dislikes it. And from this aspect of mankind, or this aspect, that man flees from that which he perceives harm, he perceives is harmful to him. From this aspect, Shaitan came to Adam alayhi salatu wa salam and whispered to him, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered mankind, I ordered Adam not to go near the tree. So Shaitan came to him and whispered to him in order to get him to disobey Allah. He whispered to him that which to make him feel secure from that which he says. Allah ordered Adam not to go near the tree. And Shaitan whispered to Adam and lured him by that which he likes, and secured him from that which he fears. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala explains, after ordering Adam to stay away from the tree, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, explaining the whispering of Shaitan, فَوَسْوَسَ إِلَيْهِ الشَّيْطَانِ, so Shaitan whispered to him, meaning to Adam, قَالَ يَا Adam, هَلْ أَدُلُّكَ عَلَى شَجَرَةِ الْخُلْدِ وَمُلْكٍ لَا يَبْلَى, should I show you, I indicate to you, or point out to you the tree of eternity and a kingdom that doesn't end? So Shaitan whispered to Adam from the vantage point of his weakness that he likes that he will live forever, and he doesn't want his possessions and the things that he has and the good that he has to end. وَمُلْكٍ لَا تَبْلَى, and a milk and possessions and a kingdom that never ends. And this is how mankind is. Mankind wishes that which he has and which he possesses doesn't end. Well, he avoids that which jeopardizes is good that he is in, or is good, or that which he perceives is good. So you find mankind fleeing from that which they perceive is harmful. that you find mankind fleeing from poverty, and you find them fleeing from sicknesses and from bad health. Even the people of disbelief, well, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has not guided them to understand that which is good and that which is bad from the Kitab and the Sunnah, or based upon the Kitab and the Sunnah. You find them fleeing from that which they perceive as evil in order to preserve the good that they have. You find them fleeing from sicknesses, fleeing from bad health. You find them stop smoking and eating good. You find them exercising. You find them avoiding intoxicants and drugs. But no doubt these things are harmful. And you find them fleeing from old age by dyeing their hair and by plastic surgery. And some of these things, there's no shame or evil in it. And they perceive that they are fleeing from that which harms the good that they are in. Or that they are fleeing from danger and fleeing to safety. And with all these precautions that mankind take out of ignorance, or by following all their desires, you still find them with all kinds of problems. They have no comfort and no contentment. They have the worst of family relations, no tranquility, no peace of mind. They live in anxiety and in worry and in sadness and in depression, and they live in regret and they live in anger. And this is all because that mankind flees from what he perceives as harmful. And he perceives that he's fleeing that which will bring him good. And he's fleeing to comfort. And he's fleeing to contentment. And he's fleeing to a peace of mind. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says in his noble book, "Tafirru ila Allah, inni lakum minhu nadhirun mubin." Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says in the book, flee to Allah. Flee to Allah. Verily, inni lakum minhu nadhirun mubin. I am to you a clear warner. This is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commands his prophet to say to mankind in a way to guide them and to protect them as a source of guidance. Tafirru ila Allah. So flee to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Verily, I am to you all a clear warner. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was sent as a warner from the punishment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So it is upon all of us to flee to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and escape from sins and obedience and disobedience, to escape from the punishment of Allah. It is upon us to flee to Allah. And mankind has preoccupied themselves from fleeing from all kinds of things. But who can flee from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? And who can flee from the punishment of Allah? And what have you fled from if you have not fled from the punishment of Allah? Even if you have fled from cancer, or if you fled from diseases, or you fled from all kinds of sickness and ailments and rheumatism and arthritis, if you have not fled from the punishment of Allah in this life, in the hereafter, what have you fled from? Tafirru ila Allah. Flee to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Flee to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from ignorance. And flee to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from his punishment. Verily, his punishment is severe. We want to take a look at a brief understanding of this ayat as a small nasiha to all of us. If you have not escaped from the punishment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, where have you escaped from? وَجَاءَ فِي الصَّحِيحَيْنِ أَنَّ النَّبِيَّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ كَانَ يَقُولُ قَبْلَ النَّاسِ. وَكَمْ صَحِيحَيْنِ أَنَّ الثَّارِي الْبُرَى بْنُ عَازِبٍ that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وسلم used to say before he went to sleep, اللهم أسلمت نفسي إليك. Oh Allah, I have submitted myself to you. I have surrendered myself to you. وَوَجَّهْتُ وَجْهِي إِلَيْكَ. I have faced my direction towards you. وَفَوَّتُ أَمْرِي إِلَيْكَ. I have handed my affairs over to you. Until he says, لَا مَلْجَأَ وَلَا مَنْجَأَ مِنْكَ إِلَّا إِلَيْكَ. There is no place to flee to. And there is no safe place to run from. To run from you. There's no escape from you. There's no safe haven from you except by fleeing to you. This is the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to say. This is part of the dua. La malja'a. There's no place to flee. There's no place to flee to. Wala manja. There's no safe haven. Minka. From you. Illa ilayk. There's no escape from you, from your punishment, except by fleeing to you. So we have to flee from the punishment of Allah by fleeing to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. لا ملجأ ولا منجأ. لا ملجأ. There's no place to flee to. ولا منجأ. There's no safe haven منك from you. إلا إليك, except to you. Subhanahu wa ta'ala. Fafirru ila Allah. So flee to Allah. Flee to Allah. There is no way to run from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Huwa al-alim, he's the all-knowing. Huwa ala kulli shay'in qadir, he is capable of everything. Huwa al-qawi, he's the strong. Huwa al-khabir, he's the well-aware. Huwa shadeed al-adab, and his punishment is severe. وهو القحار كمثلا نعم خلق النار للعصاة. He's the one who created the hellfire for the disobedient. Allah سبحانه وتعالى created the hellfire for the disobedient. So flee from that which necessitates his punishment. So that which necessitates his rahmah and his mercy and his reward. Oh, mankind. My dear brothers in Islam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded his prophet in this verse to say this to mankind. Fafirru ila Allah. Flee to Allah. Verily, I am to you all a clear warner. A warner. And this is a threat. Flee to Allah. I warn you all, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam tells mankind, of a punishment to come. So flee to Allah. There's no fleeing from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The only way to flee from Allah is by fleeing to Him subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is something that we must recognize and we must understand. The ulama of this deen, they have explained this ayat, as the Imam Shawkani, he mentions in his tafsir, فَفِرُّوا إِلَى اللَّهِ. Flee to Allah. He mentioned that some of the ulama say, فَفِرُّوا مِنْ طَاعَةِ الشَّيْطَانِ إِلَى طَاعَةِ الرَّحْمَنِ. Flee from the obedience of shaytan to the obedience of Rahman. Flee from disobedience to the obedience to Allah. Leave off the sins. Flee from disobedience. Flee from it. And when you flee from something, you don't take your time. You don't say, inshallah, I'm going to stop doing this. Hopefully I'll get no. Flee. Flee. Fafirru ila Allah. Flee shows that it's immediately. That it's immediate. And that it's quick. And that you're fleeing from that which harms you. And there's nothing that we fear for ourselves more than our own sin. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has protected the believers from all kinds of atrocities. The most dangerous thing for ourselves is our own selves, our own disobedience. and as for other than that which comes to us, from hardships and trials and tribulations, it wipes away our sins if we find ourselves patient. But our major harm is our own sins. So flee to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Flee to Allah by leaving off sins. And leaving off disobedience. As some of them say, Imam Shawkani explains, فَفِرُّ إِلَىٰ تَوْبَ مِنْ دُنُوبِكُمْ. Flee to Allah, then they can tawbah from your sin. This is how you flee to Allah. Flee to Allah, then they can tawbah. The fleeing conveys and indicates quickness, swiftness, and earnesty, and fear from punishment reaching you. In other ayahs, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَسَارِعُوا إِلَى مَغْفِرَةٍ مِنْ رَبِّكُمْ. Rush to the forgiveness of your Lord. Rush. Rush to the forgiveness of your Lord, meaning the tawbah. Rush to this. Rush to the tawbah from Allah. Rush to the repentance of Allah. Rush to the mercy of Allah. In other ayahs, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَسَارِعُوا إِلَى مَغْفِرَةٍ مِنْ رَبِّكُمْ. And complete and race and complete to the forgiveness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Tafirru ila Allah. Flee to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Imam al-Tabari, rahimahullah, he explains in his tafsir about this ayah. Tafirru ila Allah. Flee to Allah. Ihrubu ayyuhal nas min iqabillah ila rahmatihi. بالإيمان بي واتباع أمري. He says it means to escape and flee, O mankind, from the punishment of Allah to His mercy. Escape from the punishment of Allah. Flee. Flee from the punishment of Allah. Run and escape from the punishment of Allah by fleeing to the mercy of Allah, by believing in Him. الإيمان بي واتباع أمري and following his commandments. وقد جاء في صحيح مسلم أن عائشة رضي الله عنها قالت افتقدت النبي صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وسلم ذات ليلة فتحسست فوقعت يدي على بطن قدمي وهو في المسجد وهما منصوبتان وهو يقول. She said one day while she was in the bed, she missed the Messenger of Allah. She didn't know where the Prophet was in the middle of the night. So she said, I felt around with my hands until my hand fell on the bottom of his 2 feet while he was in Salah. And then his feet are planted in the ground like somebody is when they're in sujood. And the Prophet was saying, Allahumma inni a'udhu bi ridatik min sakhatik. Oh Allah, I seek refuge in your pleasure from your anger. Wa bi mu'afatik min uqubatik. And I seek refuge in your defense from your punishment. Wa a'udhu bika minka. And I seek refuge with you from you. I seek refuge in you from you. There's no way out from the punishment of Allah except by turning to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Aisha radiallahu anha woke up in the middle of the night and found the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam praying in the middle of the night. Tahajjud. And he's saying, Allahumma inni a'udhu bi ridatik min sakhatik. I seek refuge in your pleasure from your anger. Wa bi mu'afatik min uqubatik. And in your defense from your punishment. Wa a'udhu bika minka. I seek refuge in you from you. Subhanallah. We want to understand from that there's no way out. Be convinced, my dear brothers, that sins and disobedience is not the way. Leave it. Abandon it. Before you meet Allah, flee to Allah. And the way to abandon is by fleeing to Allah. With tawbah. Flee from the punishment of Allah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he has informed about the Day of Judgment and the situation, the conditions of mankind that day. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, يَقُولُ الْإِنسَانُ يَوْمَئِذٍ حَيْنَ الْمَطَرِ كَلَّا لَا وَزَرِ. Mankind, he will say that day, أَيْنَ الْمَطَرِ, where is the place to flee? There is no safe haven. This is the time now to flee. Al-firar ila Allah, al-firar. Al-firar, the fleeing is to Allah. Not to the dunya. Not to the gym. Not to the hospital. Not to the beauty salon. To Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with obedience. There's no way to escape from the punishment of Allah except by turning to Allah. يقول الإنسان يومئذٍ أين المطر. Mankind on the Day of Judgment, they're going to say, where is the place to flee? Where is the safe haven? كَلَّا لَا وَذَرُ. There's no malja. There's no place to hide. There's no place to flee لِيَوْمَ الْقِيَامِ. So now what we have the capability تَفِرُّ إِلَى اللَّهِ تَفِرُّ إِلَى اللَّهِ. Flee to Allah. إِنِّي لَكُمْ مِنْهُ نَذِيرٌ مُبِينٌ. Verily, I am to you all from him, from Allah, a clear warner. That I'm a warner. And he's warning of the punishment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala explains in the story of Ka'b ibn Malik, the Sahibi and his two partners. And Ka'b ibn Malik is the Sahabi الذي تخلف عن غزوة تبوك. He didn't go to this expedition to Tabuk. Ka'b ibn Malik, radiyallahu ta'ala anhu. He and two other Sahabas, two others from amongst the Sahaba, they delayed and became preoccupied until the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam departed. And they did not go on this expedition to Tabuk. Which led that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam commanded the Sahabas to abandon them and make hijrah from them and not even to speak to them for 50 days. 50 days. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions their tawbah in his book. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَعَلَى الثَّلَاثَةِ الَّذِينَ خُلِّفُوا حَتَّى ضَاقَتْ عَلَيْهِمُ الْأَرْضُ بِمَا رَحُبَتْ وَضَاقَتْ عَلَيْهِمْ أَنفُسُهُمْ وَظَنُّوا أَنْ لَا مَلْجَأَ مِنَ اللَّهِ إِلَّا إِلَيْهِ ثُمَّ تَابَ عَلَيْهِمْ لِيَتُوبُوا إِنَّ اللَّهَ هُوَ التَّوَّابُ الرَّحِيمُ. And Allah has accepted the tawbah of those that their matter or their issue was delayed. Allah delayed these three Sahabis the issue for 50 days. Allah then explained the situation and left them in a state of abandonment, but the Prophet and his companions did not speak to them and cut them off totally until the Prophet commanded that they separate from their wives. حَتَّى ضَاقَتْ عَلَيْهِمُ الْأَرْضُ بِمَا رَحُبَةً. The whole land, as vast as it is, and as wide as it is, became strained and tight on them. of them being abandoned, and with nobody giving them the salams. Abu bin Malik said, I went to the Prophet and said, Salaam alaikum. So I don't know if his lips moved or didn't move. I don't know if he replied to me or not. وعلى الثلاثة الذين خلفوا خلفوا means that Allah made the top on these three people. Those who خلفوا, their matter was delayed for 50 days. They had no idea what their situation was going to be after this sin that they committed. رضي الله تعالى عنهم. They were in this condition حتى ضاقت عليهم الأرض بما رحبت. Until the whole world was confined and tight and straightened on them. As vast as it is. From the hijrah that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam commanded upon them. They found the world small and bayit and tight on them. وَضَاقَتْ عَلَيْهِمْ أَنْفُسُهُمْ Their own selves became straightened and tight on them. Full of sorrow and regret and worry and anxiety. وَظَنُّوا here means وَإِيقَنُوا وَعَلِمُوا and to the point that they were sure and they were 100% and they knew absolutely أَلَّا مَلْجَأَ مِنَ اللَّهِ إِلَّا إِلَيْهِ that there's no way to flee from Allah except by going to Him. This will get them out of their situation. Now, fleeing to Allah. وَظَنُّوا that they were upon yaqeen and they were certain. They were certain. أَلَّا مَلْجَأَ مِنَ اللَّهِ There's no fleeing from Allah. إِلَّا إِلَيْهِ Except to Him. ثُمَّ تَابَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِمْ Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accepted their tawbah. When they realized that there's no way to flee from Allah except by fleeing to Him, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Inna Allahu huwa tawwab ar-raheem. Verily, Allah is the one who accepts the repentance, the one who is most merciful. So whoever finds himself in anxiety and in depression, and whoever finds himself in sin, he needs to flee to Allah, subhanahu wa ta'ala. No matter what your problems are, no matter what your shortcomings are, well, no matter what your situation is, no matter what the condition may be, how many people flee to disobedience in the time of depression, in the time of anger? They go smoke. They go listen to music. They go speak to people they shouldn't be speaking to. They sit in places that are harmful. They flee to shaitan. How many people in the time of anxiety turn to the haram? How many people in the time of depression, in the time of hardship, in the time of poverty, their way out is going to the haram? Fafirru ila Allah. Flee to Allah. Flee to Allah. There's no way out. Know that there's no way out except by fleeing to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He explained the story of Musa and his people, Israel, Israel, when they fled from Fir'aun. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala explained that because of a number of stories. Allah says in the surah of the Shu'ara, of the poets, أوحينا إلى موسى أن أسر بعبادي إنكم متبعون And we revealed to Musa to flee with my servants at night. Verily, you all will be pursued. So Musa and his people fled in the middle of the night from Fir'aun. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says, فَأَتْبَعُهُ الْمُشْرِقِينَ So Fir'aun and his people at sunrise started pursuing them and following them. فلما ترى الجمعان قال أصحاب موسى إنا لمدركون. When the two groups of people saw one another, the people of Musa said, "Verily, they're going to catch up to us, and they're going to overcome us. We're going to be overtaken." قال كلا إن معي ربي سيهدين. Moses said, "No way. Verily, my Lord is with me. He's going to guide me." While they're fleeing from Fir'aun. فأوحينا إلى موسى أن أضرب بعصاك البحر فانفلق فكان كل فرق كالطود العظيم. And we revealed to Musa to take his cane and hit with it the ocean, and it separated. And each part was like a big, big mountain. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he explains in the other ayat the details of the situation. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلَقَدْ أَوْحَيْنَا إِلَى مُوسَىٰ أَنْ أَسْرِ بِالْعِبَادِ. And we reveal to Musa, because in Surah Taha, وَلَقَدْ أَوْحَيْنَا إِلَى مُوسَىٰ أَنْ أَسْرِ بِالْعِبَادِ فَاضْرِبْ لَهُمْ طَرِيقًا فِي الْبَحْرِ يَبَسًا لَا تَخَافُ دَرَكًا وَلَا تَخْشَى. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed to Musa alayhi salatu wa salam at a time that they're fleeing from Fir'aun. And indeed, he revealed to Musa to travel by night and to use his cane to strike a path in the middle of the ocean that will be dry. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made the path dry. It's not even moist. It's not even muddy. Totally dry. Each side is like a tall mountain. This is because they fled to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the ones who flee to Allah, Allah will secure their way and secure their path. So the people of Musa, they fled to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made a way for them. And to the point, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَضْرِبْ لَهُمْ طَرِيقًا فِي الْبَحْرِ يَبَسًا. Strike a path for them in the sea that will be dry. They'll walk through the sea comfortable and secured and protected and defended. And the sea divided on both sides is two mountains. لا تخاف دركا ولا تخشى. And don't be afraid of drowning. This is what we want to benefit in small nasiha from this ayat as at the end of Surah Al-Bariyat. Afirru ila Allah, flee to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Flee to Him and rush to Him and compete for His forgiveness and race to His forgiveness. Afirru ila Allah, flee to Allah from His punishment. Flee to His mercy. Flee to His forgiveness. هو أرحم الراحمين. He's the most merciful of those who show mercy. هو خير الغافرين. He's the best of those who forgive. And mankind has preoccupied themselves fleeing for that which they think will benefit them. And unfortunately, they flee to that which harms them. They want status, and they want to be known, and they want worldly things. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has promised them this and more. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, as it comes from the hadith, Abu Hurairah radiallahu anhu, وَمَا اجْتَمَعَ قَوْمٍ فِي بَيْتٍ مِنْ بُيُوتِ اللَّهِ. And no people have gathered in the house from the houses of Allah. يَتْلُونَ كِتَابُ اللَّهِ. They're reciting the book of Allah. وَيَتَدَارَسُونَهُ بَيْنَهُمْ. And they're standing amongst them. إِلَّا نَزَلَتْ عَلَيْهِمُ السَّكِينَةُ. Except that the sakina and tranquility comes upon them. وَغَشِيَتْهُمُ الرَّحْمَةِ. And the rahmah from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has covered them. وَحَفَّتْهُمُ الْمَلَائِكَةِ. And the malaika have surrounded them, and it shows protection. It shows protection from Allah for those that go to the masjid, and those that seek ilm, and those that study, and those who are upon obedience. وَحَفَّتْهُمُ الْمَلَائِكَةِ وَذَكَرَهُمُ اللَّهُ فِي مَنْ عِنْدَكَ. And Allah mentions them for those that are amongst. Allah mentions them. And how many flee to disobedience so that they be mentioned, and that they may be seen, or that they may be recognized, or that such and such will mention them, or recognize them, or that they will sit with such and such. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentions in this hadith, those that go to the masjid, and those that study, and are upon obedience, وَذَكَرَهُمُ اللَّهُ فِي مَنْ عِنْدَهُ. As it comes in another hadith, أَنَا عِنْدَ ذَلِّ عَبْدِي بِي وَعَلَ مَأَهُ حِينَ يَذْكُرُونَ. I'm in accordance with my servant thought of me. وَعَلَ مَأَهُ حِينَ يَذْكُرُونَ. And I'm with him when he remembers me. اَذَكْرَنِي فِي خَيْرٍ إِنْ ذَكَرَنِي فِي نَفْسِهِ ذَكَرْتُهُ فِي نَفْسِهِ. If he mentions me in himself, I mention him in myself. This is a hadith Qudsi that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Prophet said that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying it. وَإِنْ ذَكَرَنِي فِي مَلَئٍ ذَكَرْتُهُ فِي مَلَئٍ خَيْرٌ مِنْهُ. And if he mentions me, my servant mentions me in a group of people, I mention him in a group that's better. So it's upon us to flee to Allah, and it's upon us to fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and strive to escape from the punishment of Allah by fleeing to Him. Subhanaka Allahumma wa bihamdik. Ashhadu an la ilaha illa ant. Astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk.
Na'am, barakallahu fika maki. Abdul Hakeem, are you taking questions?
Alhamdulillah, barakallahu. Insha'Allah.
Now we have a question, offline question. The person is saying, Assalamu alaikum.
Alaikum salam.
The question is saying, if a person makes her intentions to pledge $1,000 to a masjid upon correct guidance, Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah, the $1,000 was agreed to be paid off in 6 months. The first payment has been made. Can she change her intentions and give this donation to the masjid that is on the correct path because the masjid is no longer on correct guidance? It has a new imam and new administration that is not following the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Barakallahu feek.
These pledges of sadaqah, these are good. They're not binding, and they're not wajib, except if somebody made an oath that they're going to pay this money, or that they swore by Allah that they're going to fulfill such a commitment. If somebody decided to give sadaqah and then they changed their mind, then inshallah there's no problem with that. And as the person mentioned, it's good to give sadaqah to the people of the sunnah and to aid the masjids of the sunnah. And it's also for everybody to understand that the masajid, they're in need of sadaqah. And even more specifically, people should look into exactly what is needed and try to take responsibility and feel responsible of if they can't handle the total cost of the needs of the masjid, whether it be the lighting or whether it be the rent or whether it be other things that the masjid may need, water or gas or maintenance, you know, that they commit, and try to handle part of these things are good. As far as it being wajib, and this is not wajib, and if somebody sees that they give their sadaqah someplace else, then inshallah this is good, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best.
Now the next questioner is saying, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Wa alaikum salam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
With respect to many du'at calling to Salafia in the West, previously the du'at used to have their credentials mentioned on many sites. But as of today, we are unable to access these sites for who they may have studied with and the length of time they studied under the shuruq and what books they studied. How should we understand this? Do we consider them students or not since their condition remains unknown? What do you advise us with in respect to these du'at?
If somebody has studied, no matter where they have studied, and they have acquired ilm, and they are upon guidance, then it's important for the Muslims to try to benefit from them. As far as writing their credentials, and let it be known that we, the students of knowledge, we're masakin. We don't have any credentials. We have a little bit of ilm. We have nothing. We're nothing. We're nobody. We just benefited a little bit. We have no credentials. We have no resume. We have nothing. We just benefited a little bit from the ulama. The little bit that we got, we try to share it with the people as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala permits. So don't be fooled by credentials, and don't look at credentials and as if it's some kind of resume, and that people are, it's upon them to say, I sat with Sheikh Fulan, I sat with Sheikh Fulan. Maybe somebody hasn't sat with Sheikh Fulan and Sheikh Fulan, and they don't have a number of mashayikh that they sat with, but mashallah, he studied Arabic and he knows how to teach Arabic, or he memorized Quran, and he sat with another brother who's probably his age or younger than him, who understands Quran. And everybody's not known. Everybody's not known. Even one time I went to the Sheikh Yahya Hafizullah, but some people were saying that if somebody's not known, then don't sit with him. We don't know him. Don't sit with him. I mean, we don't know who he studied with, where he was at. He just comes back, you know, to the community. And he, what we see from him, that he's upon guidance and he's obedient to Allah and he prays in the masjid and he's teaching him, but we don't know where he studied from. They use this word that he's a majhul. They use this word that he's unknown. When I told it to the sheikh, he looked out and in front of him was about maybe 3,000 students. He said, "You think I know all these people here in front of me? You think I know all these people right there?" And the sheikh doesn't know everybody by their name. Some people come, they might put a mouth, the sheikh might shake their head one time, he doesn't see him again, he doesn't know his name, it's not like that. It's not like that. And this was the small sitting. The people in the Salaf, they used to have sittings of 30,000 people and 20,000 students, man. But what's important, that if somebody benefited, and some people benefit from students, everybody doesn't benefit from the sheikh. Everybody doesn't benefit from a sheikh. If somebody benefits and they have the ilm, you're miskeen. You're in need of studying. You need somebody to help you with alif baqa, to read Arabic, to memorize Quran, to learn how to make wudu. Not because he didn't sit with and the people that you're pleased with, you're not willing to sit with them. No, if somebody's upon istiqamah, somebody's steadfast, and he has acquired the ilm from the Quran and Sunnah. Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, as he mentioned before, بَلِّغُ عَنِّي وَلَوْ آيَةً. Convey on me, even if it's one verse, even if it's one thing. If somebody has acquired this one thing, or two things, or 10 things, about the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And he wants to share it with his brother. He doesn't need a consent slip. He doesn't need a letter. He doesn't need a voucher. He doesn't need it. The Prophet said, بَلِّغُ عَنِّي نَبْضَرَ اللَّهُمْ رِئًا سَمِعَ مِنَّا مَقَالَ فَبَلَّغَهَا كَمَا سَمِعَهَا. May Allah put light in the face of the one that heard from me a statement, and he can raise it as he heard it. Allah made, the Prophet made dua for this person. They heard from me a statement, and he conveyed it like he heard it. Well, this person heard more than one statement. He heard a lot of statements to the point that he finished this book, and he finished that book. And he sat with either ulama, or he sat with students, whether you want to call them a strong student or a weak student. He sat with those who understand, and he sat with those that understand and benefit him, and he understands this ilm. Then it's upon you all to raise and benefit from these people. And don't make small of your dua that are there because of these type of prerequisites that you place upon them, as far as he doesn't have any vouchers, he doesn't have credentials. The credentials is for the ulama. As far as us, we're small town, we're nothing. We're just from Bab Ta'awun, from the vantage point of trying to help out. Just from the vantage point of helping out. We're just a step ahead of others. Y'all are just right behind us. We have not gone nowhere. We just benefit a little bit. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best. We ask him to increase amongst us talab al-ilm. Ask him to increase from us talab al-ilm. Don't make small of the ni'mah of talab al-ilm. Somebody that might learn Arabic, this brother might know Quran, this brother might know aspects of Arabic, this brother might know how to read Quran, this brother might know how to write in different calligraphy and penmanships and khutut, this brother might study some books of Aqidah, this brother might have to study Salah and Wudu. All he studied was Salah and Wudu, and he traveled. That ilm is not enough? You need more than that? Yeah, don't make small of that. Benefit from who comes to you and is upon guidance. Benefit from those who come to you with them and they are upon guidance. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best.
Now, tell you. The next questioner is saying, Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum salam wa rahmatullah.
If a man takes his wife to a doctor's appointment on the other wife's time, does he have to make up however much time was spent with the wife whose time it was? Jazakallahu khair.
Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best. These issues of time is upon a man to be fair and to be equal. But sometimes emergencies occur. These kinds of situations where emergencies occur, and he has to take his wife to the hospital, these things are not to be considered that he was unfair and that he has to restart the whole time system again, and now that he took, you know, this one to the hospital. Certain things happen. Certain things are emergency. And it's upon, you know, everybody to lower their wing a little bit and try to find an even balance as far as it being wise of him to, for lack of a better word, pay this time back. To make up for this lost time, then if it's something that is emergency, then this is not upon him. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows that.
Now, the next question is asking, what should somebody do when he doesn't remember how much of fasting he missed? So he doesn't know how much
what? I didn't understand.
The question is saying, what should somebody do when he doesn't remember how much fasting he missed? So he doesn't know how much he still has to fast.
They mentioned that it's upon the person to estimate as much as he can. If he's not sure, then he estimate and as much as he can and fulfill that which he estimates. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best.
Jazakallah, brother. That's it for the questions.
Alhamdulillah. سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك اشهد ان لا اله الا انت استغفرك واتوب اليك والسلام عليكم ورحمه الله وبركاته